Hi, I'm Richa Verman, and I'm here to talk about Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, one of India's most significant leaders, but about whom we know very little. Penguin's new book, The Radical in Ambedkar, edited by scholars Suraj Yengde and Anand Teltumde, shows how Ambedkar was a global thinker who engaged with some of the most complex problems that the world is still trying to solve. Dr. Ambedkar is celebrated as the father of India's constitution and a leader of the Dalits, but as a thinker and scholar, he was much ahead of his time, and he was a visionary. For example, he was very interested in India's foreign policy. Unlike Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, he believed in a more pragmatist approach and that India should be more friendly with the US. In fact, as Suraj mentions in the book, one of the reasons for Dr. Ambedkar's famous resignation from Parliament in 1951 is India's faulty foreign policy. Let's hear Suraj talk about it.
Ambedkar is one of the prominent and pioneering leaders during the independence struggle, who comes out as a singularly focused person who puts India constantly within the global map. Ambedkar is a foreign policy strategist. Ambedkar in his Scheduled Caste Federation had a specific column which decidedly talked about problems of Indian foreign policy. In that, he charts out what are the kind of problems that Indian Republic is going to face and is currently facing. He was critical of the Nehruvian doctrine, which was almost focused with the idea of Asia for Asiatics. Ambedkar argued that Asia for Asiatic was good for as long as colonial rule was in existence. Now that we do not have the colonial burden, we have to focus on finding more pragmatic strategies. This is where Ambedkar's pragmatic best comes to the fore, where he doesn't hesitate to align with America, to align with Western powers, because he argues that we need two things. We need one financial muscle as well as resources, the intellectual as well as scientific developments that these countries are involved in. This very much came from Ambedkar's experience, wherein he was involved in building India's one of the largest dams, Damodar Valley. In addition to that, Ambedkar was also aware that Indian treasury is not enough to sustain this huge mass. So he recommended that we need to go with the countries who are willing to support us.
Dr. Ambedkar believed that the problems of the world are interconnected, and he spent his entire life trying to figure out how to tackle them. He brought the issue of caste discrimination to the world stage and compared it with racism. In modern India, Dr. Ambedkar single-handedly addressed a variety of issues related to the oppressed, which ultimately elevated him to the status of a messiah. Dr. Kevin Brown, who has contributed to this volume, draws a comparison between Dr. Ambedkar and popular leaders of the anti-racism movement.
There are unquestionably several parallels to the African-American struggle against white supremacy in the U.S. and the Dalit struggle against caste-based oppression in India. African-Americans also have several outstanding individuals who have been major leaders of our struggle here, including people like Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, and Martin Luther King Jr. But I would say that there is no single individual who is significant to the African American struggle as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was to the Dalit struggle. As one scholar put it, for the Dalit masses, Dr. Ambedkar is everything together: a first-rate scholar, a Moses who led his people out of bondage, a bodhisattva in the Buddhist tradition. He is like a god.
Dr. Ambedkar believed in building international solidarity. W.E.B. Du Bois was a leading black intellectual and civil rights activist. He was the founder of The Crisis, the oldest black publication in the world. Many of those who participated in the civil rights movement contributed to The Crisis, a hugely influential journal.
Ambedkar was a very hopeful internationalist who argued and who hoped that the future of Dalit lies within the global index of human rights. Whatever globally oppressed communities are suffering, Dalit sufferings is also related. Post-independent India, the situation of Dalits becomes worsened. Ambedkar is insecure about what is going to happen in future to the Dalits. Therefore, during that time, he reaches out to a legendary black intellectual as well as activist who was taking the issue of race to United Nations organization. Ambedkar writes a letter to Du Bois requesting him if he could solicit his support in advancing and advocating the rights of the Dalits. In the apartheid regime, as we saw, Nehru was involved in advocating for the African as well as the third world solidarity. Ambedkar argued that the South African apartheid is existing in every villages in India. Therefore, we also need to address this question. Nehru overlooks, and after Nehru, successive governments very cleverly ignored the caste question as much as they can. To understand how Ambedkar understood Dalit struggle, it was not through insular way of looking through only Brahminic text or the Hindu text or the Buddhist or the Indian geographical text. Ambedkar understood Dalit struggle through a global vision, a universalist approach that could present Dalit as a militant as well as a formative category that will emphasize its existence on its own term.
Dr. Ambedkar also tried to raise the issue of caste in the United Nations. He knew that by bringing it into the international arena, India would be accountable to end the practice of untouchability and discrimination. Perhaps if he had succeeded, certain people in India wouldn't be forced into certain professions, like manual scavenging and garbage collection, just because they were born into a certain community. This is the concept of hereditary stigmatization, which, thanks to Dr. Ambedkar, scholars around the world have been able to understand. Simply put, this means discrimination based on one's birth. Dr. Gary Michael Tartakov, who has contributed to this book, made a fascinating discovery that this kind of discrimination existed not just against the Dalits in India and blacks in Europe and America, but also against the Jews of medieval Christian Europe,
who have been, like the Dalits and African Americans, traditionally denied political participation, intermarriage, education, common employment, and becoming subject to extreme forms of segregation, violence, torture, rape, and mass murder.
If you look at mainstream politics, Dr. Ambedkar was a sharp observer there as well. The term minority carries a lot of significance today, where different identity groups are fighting for their rights. In his chapter in the book, Dr. Partha Chatterjee reveals how Dr. Ambedkar had a unique way of determining who constitutes a minority. He based it not on numerical strength, but the lack of social and political power. Let's hear what Dr. Chatterjee has to say about it.
Of all of India's political leaders at the time, I think Ambedkar had the most advanced academic training. He was an extremely careful and rigorous thinker. And this comes out very strongly in his thinking on minority rights. But he worked out a very elaborate and rigorous theory which specified under what conditions minorities could claim a right to self-determination as a nationality, where rich and wealthy and powerful minorities did not need to be considered as minorities, and of course the case of Dalits. Many of the conditions from Ambedkar's time have changed in India, but I think Ambedkar's theory still has a great deal to tell us and to teach us about the conditions that we face today.
These are only a few of the many unknown and unexplored aspects of Dr. Ambedkar's legacy. As you can see, there is much to him that we don't know about. And the book, The Radical in Ambedkar, tries to fill that gap. In the book, you'll find other fascinating discussions, such as how Ambedkar expanded the definition of democracy, how we can use his ideas for women's emancipation today, and whether or not the mass conversion of Dalits to Buddhism was a good idea. The book shows that Dr. Ambedkar was a radical rather than a reformer, and how his ideas are critical to building a just and equal India.